My subject is basically about force structure, mivne kohot. If you run a restaurant, you have to decide what food people will want to eat during the day. So you have to decide how much meat to get, how much fish to get, how much vegetables. But if you run a restaurant, your clients don't specifically try to avoid the food you have. Whereas if you build a force structure and you choose to have this much air force, this much armor, this much infantry and so on, your enemy, of course, is not your customer. He doesn't want this. He avoids that. And enemies are very uncooperative. They're not polite. In Vietnam, the United States found that the Viet Cong was really rude. They refused to assemble in conveniently targetable mass formations. This was a terrible problem. Enemies are like that. So I would like to address this issue of force structure, but to do so in a kind of elementary way. The first military training I got was in the British Army. So they gave me a 303 rifle, which was not so advanced as the Mauser that you call Czechy in Israel, less advanced, but we had a bayonet. And they said to us, first you have to show that you're willing to kill the enemy with the bayonet, and we run up and we dig it in and so on, then the Queen will give you some ammunition. And so I asked the sergeant, I said, yesterday, Her Majesty's Armed Forces detonated a thermonuclear weapon. Why do I need the bayonet? And he says, if you have the bayonet, you have moral superiority of the enemy. You're running to him with a bayonet, he runs away, his morale collapses. And as for these nuclear weapons, the sergeant said, they are so powerful that they will not let us use them. Now, from that moment to the present, this has been one constant, which is the eternal return of the infantry and the eternal failure of the people who don't understand the deep reason for the return of the infantry. Now, how does the infantry return? Well, let's say the American operation in Afghanistan. I was actually present at the very beginning, the really first few days, and in the first few days it was incredibly advanced. There was invisible B-52 bombers, or whatever it was, maybe it was F-18s from the Persian Gulf, invisibly dropping precision weapons that the Green Berets, the Special Forces, lasered onto the target. And the target consisted of Taliban assembled on hilltops to prevent the advance of the Northern Alliance and the Green Berets. And it was wonderful. I mean, this is a great war. You're standing here, you're watching a hill in Afghanistan, and you see the hill being blown away and the Taliban blown away. But, so it started beautifully. And then, of course, the Taliban learned not to assemble. And they started spreading out and disappearing and doing other stuff. And in the end, I was not there. After a short time, it was all American infantry. It was American infantrymen with a rifle going into a village against the Taliban with a rifle. So what we witness here is a process which has been going on since 1945. Until 1945, wars were very progressive phenomena. Very progressive. You start the Second World War in 1939 with biplanes, two-wing planes, and you come out with jet engines. War was advancing you. Well, since 1945, wars regress you. They bring you back. I mean, and it starts in Korea already. In Korea, at the beginning, it was all air power, and the Marines, and they had just developed napalm and some, and they were going to blow away the enemy with napalm. And then, of course, it went back to the infantry. So what we have here is a regression. So don't think for a moment that what happened in Israel, which is to start with large-scale maneuver operations, armor mechanized operations in the depths of Sinai, or in Golan and so on, and then you regress to Hamas and knives and so on. This is exactly what happened to everybody. Everybody it happened. Happened to the British in Afghanistan, it happened there, in every situation it happened. The only exception was the Gulf War, the first Gulf War, I mean 1991, where of course there was precision bombing and there were targets for it, and it was a wonderful thing. I was actually working for Checkmate. I was a targeteer. My only disappointment was that early on, a correspondent of CBS called Simon crossed the border from Kuwait to Iraq, and I hated Simon every time he appeared on television. I didn't like him. I tried to put a bomb right on the police station, but they had moved him. So, but most other bombings worked very well. Now, this is the premise to address the issue today. But everybody talked about Meir Dagan, and so will I. Now, General Amidror and Kupferwasser and all these people here worked with Dagan in a serious professional way. I did not. The only thing I ever did with Dagan is that I went on a raid with him. He was a Rafsaren, and we went on a raid, which is the deepest raid that the Israeli armed forces have ever conducted in Lebanon, because we went all the way to Jebel, which the tourist board calls Biblios, and we went beyond Jebel right up to the gates of Tarabulus and so on. And at that time, all I knew about Meir Dagan was that he was pretty good with an M16, because he had an M16, he was riding on one vehicle, I was in the other, and I fired more ammunition than he did, but he was more accurate, I have to say. So this is Meir Dagan's memory I have. Now, the issues that we've heard today from different people, and we've heard this word, which legitimacy all the time. Okay. Well, this is a new thing, of course, terribly new. Well, perhaps not terribly, terribly new. Because in Homer, in the Iliad, they are quite proud about killing people. And the hero, Achilles, says, how wonderful it will be to see when I kill Horace, how his mother cries. And this is great. However, by 1415, when King Henry V decided to enter France to claim the French crown, he felt it necessary to have a whole propaganda campaign explaining that the king of the British crown, actually, they were the legitimate rulers of France. Because France was under the Salic law, and the Salic law prevented female succession, something like Trump will argue with Hillary Clinton, you know, that you don't really want a woman there and so on. So by 1415, a king in Europe was very preoccupied with the issue of legitimacy. He had the whole argument worked out of why he was legally entitled to have it. The Church of England read it in every church in England, the legal explanation of how the king had the right to land in France and do the war, and the British Church passed it to the Roman Church, which passed it around, and so on and so forth. In other words, by 1415, this may be news to the Chelavir of Israel, by 1415, a king wanted to do a war, legitimacy was his big concern. He wanted to maintain legitimacy because he wanted domestic legitimacy, he wanted legitimacy with his army, and you have, by 1415, the notion is that when you build a military operation, your first concern is legitimacy. They did that before landing in France. Now, they had other advantages. At the Battle of Agincourt, the British had the bow and arrow, which was the weapon of the weak and the poor. The French enemy was armored cavalry. It was described as the flower of the French aristocracy. These were expensive people on expensive horses. So they had the advantage of being the David versus Goliath thing, so they had every possible advantage. They won the war. Now, the question about Henry V and all that kind of stuff brings me to one of the threats now, which is one of the ways in which Israel is experiencing the general universal regression of war, which is instead of having Syrian divisions, armored divisions that you fight with Israeli divisions, you have Hezbollah. Now, according to the analysis that I would make of force structure, which is if I was running a restaurant, what kind of food I would put on, and to deal with a customer who is not trying to look for food, but is trying to avoid it. On that basis, I would say that my answer when I look at Hezbollah would be 10 infantry brigades, 10 Chativot of Khir. And if you're short of 10 Chativot of Khir, I can advise you that you can take some forces away, troops away from the special forces, from the Sayarot, the Kohot Miuchadot, and all that, and put them back into regular infantry, and then you cross the border into Lebanon. Of course, only when they start launching rockets, naturally, they have to start launching rockets. And then you cross the border and you go into every village and every house and every martef. And of course, they will launch many rockets before you can get there, but others you can prevent them. And then you go up to the Litani, and of course, in the meantime, you have some two or three, you know, armored task forces, I don't know, Chativot, Ugdot, something like that, running up to the Litani so you can come back, and that kind of operation. Now, when you do that kind of operation, there is no air force. Therefore, you don't have David and Goliath. You have the British troops just with bows and arrows, and the guys with the horses and the armor, that's not you. You're on the right side, you don't have any bombing going on, you don't have air power against poor people on the ground, they can't bring out dead babies in Beirut and all that kind of stuff. So you have the instrument that you're using is an instrument that legitimizes you. Because there you are, a people taking weapons to defend themselves, using the rifle, I hope with the bayonet. If you don't have bayonet, there are plenty of, you can buy bayonets on the world market. They're not controlled by sanctions. You don't even need a license for them. And you cross over, and by doing that, you have a people in arms protecting itself against nefarious rockets and missiles supplied by other people to Hezbollah and so on. And of course, in the current Sunni-Shia confrontation, Hezbollah doesn't have the basic political popularity they had last time. They don't have sustainment, political sustainment within Lebanon or within the Middle East or within the Muslim world or the Arab world or anywhere. And secondly, the resupply from Syria, once they get new rockets, has become very precarious and much more easily interrupted. So that would be an example of fighting Hezbollah, recognizing, first of all, that Israel is not in a unique position at all. It's a very common, everybody's situation now, to be forced back to the infantry, applying it, paying the minimum price politically, the legitimacy argument, the loss of legitimacy is minimized, because what you see is people defending themselves from rockets using rifles and not bombing entire cities or populations and so on and so forth. And, you know, this would be what I would recommend. Now, in every known political system, Optimization is always impeded by structure. You have a certain structure, you organize in a certain way. Structure limits optimization. For example, I live in Washington, and communications with New York are pretty precarious. We don't have high-speed train. I do work in other places in the world where I need to go from A to B. I take a high-speed train, I'm there. In America, you can't have a high-speed train because the American political system is a system where every locality has the power to control the passage of the railway. Every mayor and county can stop it. And every one of them says, of course you can have a high-speed train, of course, but you have to stop in my town. And if you stop in every town, it will be the slowest high-speed train in the world and slower than the current slow train. So in other words, if you have organized a structure historically where the Chel Avir has a lot of money, a lot of power, a lot of influence, and a lot of, even though in the Matkal there's only one guy called Chel Avir, they're all over the place infiltrating Tichnun and all these other things. And the Chel Avir comes along with these arguments saying, oh, you don't need to fight. No, you don't need to fight. Who needs to go there with a rifle and a bayonet? We alone are going to be exempted from the universal law that forces you to do fighting in this way. We alone, we're not going to do it. We're going to do it all with the Chel Avir. Now, the problem is, of course, that Hezbollah fails to cooperate. Namely, they did not rebuild the whole headquarters structure they used to have in Beirut. And the issue will be what kind of target you're going to bomb if you're going to make demonstrations and so on and so forth. And if you're going to bomb villages instead of sending here in villages, then you're going to pay the price in legitimacy. Now, of course, you will tell me immediately that there's the issue of casualties, and therefore, let's call it internal legitimacy. And, you know, when you're dealing with strategy, you're not in the same position as a housewife. So, you know, if you want to have a housewife mentality about casualties, then you really cannot even enter the house of strategy. You better stay outside and do something else. So these are fundamental force structure issues to be dealt with, but I repeat, there's nothing very, you know, special and particular about this kind of thing. Now, one other remark. When I said that there's been a change in legitimacy, and I brought it back to King Henry V in 1415, you know, the Battle of Agincourt and so on, you will notice at that time television was not highly developed, and social media in 1415 were pretty primitive and so on, yet already then it was absorbed by every king in Europe that you have to do this. So I'm a little surprised that I now see people, I just saw a policy paper just floating around about how Israel can really influence the mentality of the Hamas people and so on and so forth by applying maximum military pressure on them and crushing them and so on and so forth. Now, if you are in a situation where you're fighting a world war, like the United States was fighting a world war in 1945, and there was the United States on one side, the enemy on the other, and you can use fission bombs and so on, this was in a world in which the only neutrals, the only spectators, were Tonga and Portugal. Today, things are different. Israel is not alone as a superpower facing Japan. Israel, there are many other players, including Harvard University, very regrettably. Of course, President Trump will take care of that problem, but we have to wait till next January. Thank you. Sit down.